Good morning.
Good morning.
Reverend Grayland Scott Hagler is our senior minister. Welcome to Plymouth Congregational United Church of Christ. And I greet you this morning as we continue to practice social distancing and use these meetings to be together. We will reopen when it seems safe and appropriate to do so. But we invite you in the meantime to join us for Bible study on Tuesdays, Wednesdays for our dial up and prayer up, power up prayer call, Thursdays for our midweek service and prayer, and Fridays for our spiritual grounding session. On tomorrow, Monday, at 7 o'clock p.m., we will have our healing circle to pray for healing in our bodies and spirits, for the nation, sanity in insane times, and express thanksgiving for bringing us thus far in our life's journey. We are located at 5301 North Capitol Street Northeast in Washington, D.C. We are thankful and honored that you are joining with us this morning. We are a church of deep history, progressivism, and liberation. When we do reopen, you are welcome to worship with us. And if you have been blessed by these services these past few months, we hope that you would join us in this work of love, this passion for justice, and this mission of Jesus from this corner into the world. This is the third Sunday of Advent, and on the Christian calendar, it is a time of watching and waiting with great anticipation and hopefulness. Today, we will light our Advent candles, and being the second Sunday of the month, it is our Communion Sunday. We invite you to gather the elements that you want to use for communion, and at an appropriate time, we will take part together in the sacrament of Holy Communion. Advent is a time where we focus on gifts and giving, but often become focused on shopping and buying giving gifts and expecting gifts. But let this season truly be a season of giving, real giving, heartfelt giving, and the giving of things that are not material but touches the depths of our soul. For God has given to us the greatest gift of all, and we call him our Emmanuel. Have a blessed Advent and a grace-filled Christmas. We wait for the transition of power in this nation, just like at the birth of Jesus, Mary, his mother, exuded hope and anticipation at the rising of a Messiah and the dismantling of malicious power. Read Mary's song slowly. We will hear it today. With an eye towards meaning and detail, feel it deep in your spirit. We remain committed to justice, hope, and light, and shall trust the presence and power of God until the change that the soul desire comes. This is what worship is about, not only getting right in our spirits and heart and getting right with the divine, but it also means refueling and regaining strength and perspective for the continued work ahead. We continue working towards freedom and justice and wholeness. We continue to work towards the manifestation of the perfection of God. We embody what Fannie Lou Hamer said, nobody is free until everybody is free.
Oh, yeah.
Come, worship, and lift praises, because this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen. Thank you, Deacon Taylor. And now we've come to the time of our Advent litany. And as I read, your response will be, God be with us in the light of joy. And we will light the first two candles and then the third. Today we reflect upon the theme of joy and rejoicing. God's Spirit is at work anointing people to a future building and the dominant image throughout the readings of joy. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice is the refrain in the readings. The traditional name of the third Sunday of Advent is Gaudete Sunday, from the Latin word of rejoice in Philippians 4, 4 through 5. Gaudete in Domino Semper Rejoice in the Lord, always. The Lord is near. We now light the first two candles of Advent, symbolizing the peace and the hope.
Oh, Holy One, we light the third candle and delight in the sparkle of this outrageous reminder to rejoice. Let its flame cast light into the shadowy places and show where work is to be done. Let a community of builders be formed in light joy. Let joy find home in our hearts and make space for your presence there as we work for justice and peace in the service of Lord. Love. I invite you to repeat after me. God be with us in this light of joy.
This is our call to worship. Rejoice, the Spirit of God is sending us. I'm going to ask you to repeat after me. To bring good news to the oppressed.
To bring good news to the oppressed.
To comfort the brokenhearted.
To comfort the brokenhearted.
To proclaim liberty to the captive.
To proclaim liberty to the captives.
To proclaim the year of favor among God's people.
To proclaim the year of favor among God's people.
Rejoice, the work of the Spirit is calling us. And repeat after me. To rebuild ancient relationships ruined by injustice.
To rebuild ancient relationships ruined by injustice.
To repair the cities as places of hope.
To repair cities as places of hope.
To restore land devastated across generations.
To restore land devastated across generations.
To proclaim the year in favor among God's people.
To proclaim the year of favor among God's people.
Rejoice. The glory of the Spirit is leaving us. I invite you to repeat after me. To cast off any faint spirit.
To cast off any faint spirit.
And put on the mantle of praise.
And put on the mantle of praise.
To take root as the plantings of the Holy One.
To take root as the plantings of the Holy One.
To display God's glory.
To display God's glory.
Come, let us worship in joy. We'll now move a moment about into our invocation. Holy One, builder who delights in making spaces of safety and beauty, matchmaker who rejoices in presenting new spouses with a future of hope, fill us today with your gifts we need to join you in your life, sustaining hope, giving work in the world. Let us share your joyful vision of beauty and justice. In this world, you have created and loved in the name of the one who is coming. Amen.
Amen.
As we move into a moment of preparation for our prayer. Oh, come, let us adore him. Rejoice, y'all. Oh, come, let us rejoice.
Oh, come, let us adore you. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord.
For he alone is worthy.
For he alone.
Please continue to pray for Deacon Maxine Luther. We pray for Clarence Heller, who is in the hospital. We pray that God's healing grace will surround him. Continue to pray for those who have let us know the needs of those who have and those who have not. We pray for those who are emotionally disturbed, for those who are depressed in this season, and for the healing of the nation. We pray for those who are unemployed and who have been laid off and underemployed. Pray for a new day and a new way. Pray, work, and love like never before. Let us pray. On this day, Lord, we come before you. In this season of Advent, we come, Lord, for we believe that Jesus has come and Jesus will come again. But in the meantime, Lord, we who are your faithful followers, continue to do all we know to do to keep on moving forward in spite of the doubts of others, our own distrust within ourselves. We press towards the mark of a high call of God. In between time, Lord, we keep on having a vision of peace, hope, and love. We keep moving forward in spite of it all, Lord, where there's upheaval in the land. We know full well that our faith will see us through. So we keep on keeping on. In the words of our ancestors, and stand on the shoulders of those who've gone on before. We keep moving and we keep rejoicing, believing and trusting that one day you shall appear. But until then, Lord, we ask, oh God, that our faith is deep enough and wide enough to sustain us in moments of despair. So, Lord, we pray for our pastor and his leadership. We ask, Lord, in the name of Jesus, that you continue to bless him. We ask in the name of Jesus that you continue to prop him up on every leading side. And we ask for the miraculous healing that continue to take place in his body. For we believe it and it is so.
Yes, God.
We pray for this congregation, oh God, and for all of its many blessings. Those who have been faithful in carrying out the service, even in the midst of a pandemic, we have been faithful to you, Lord. And because of this, we know full well that there is something better on the other side when this pandemic is over.
Amen.
We're deep enough and wide enough to receive everything you're going to have for us. We pray for each and every member on our sick and shut-in list. We pray that, Lord, that you will stop by their hospital rooms. Stop by their beds of affliction. Go by wherever they are in need, Lord. Let them know that people here at Plymouth are praying for them, because we believe in the power of prayer. We believe that everything's going to be all right. So, Lord, we pray. We keep on praying. We keep on mouthing the words of how wonderful and how gracious and how wonderful, how glorious you are. During this time, Lord, we don't have nothing else to give but this great hope which is in you. We pray for our city. Lord knows we're praying for our country. We're praying for its leadership, Lord. We know that sometimes things got to be shaken up in order to be put back neatly. And so, Lord, we welcome all that is taking place in this country right now, because we know that the people who are followers of Christ eventually will win, because we show forth the love, the grace, and the mercy of God. We continue to pray for this world. We continue to pray for those in this moment, oh God, who are searching for answers and find it difficult to find. Lord, we ask now that you will continue to bless us here on this corner. Bless us, Lord, for we are standing ready and available to receive the blessings that you have for us. Bless us so that we can be a blessing to others. We promise to give your name all glory and all of the honor for that which has been given to us, which comes from you. When we come to the end of life's journey, the battle has been fought, and victory has been won. Oh Lord, we will stand before you. All we want to hear is the words, well done, good and a faithful servant. You've been a faithful over a few things.
We turn this prayer over to you right now in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
And the people of God say, amen.
Amen.
The people of God say, amen.
Amen.
Adore Him, Christ the Lord.
This is our moment of praise, y'all. Our moment of praise. Come on, give it all that hand praise, y'all. Wherever you are.
www.plymouth-ucc.org under sermons. There's video sermons, some podcasts as well as video. So there is, so you don't have to be a member now of Facebook to be able to access the service. You can go directly to the website and access the service. Or you can go to Facebook if that's what you're more comfortable with. But what we wanted to make sure is that there were alternatives in place so that people could more easily access the worship service, particularly as we stream online. And I want to particularly, I'm going to come back to Marion Peel, because Marion has obsessed on this and has stayed awake and has worked on it, tried to figure it out, figured it out, and has gotten the job done. And I want to thank you, Sister Peel, for your ministry. Now, we invite you to spend at least one more additional hour with us during the week. And what I mean by that is you're invited to join us in Bible study. On Tuesdays at 12 noon, we are studying 2 Corinthians. Come and be a part of that. You can join us in midweek service and prayer on Thursday nights at 6:30. Or you can join with us in our spiritual grounding on Fridays at 12 noon. All of these gatherings take place on the GoToMeeting platform. On Wednesday morning at 6 a.m., there is our dial-up and power-up prayer line, and that is a dial-in gathering, and we thank Reverend Garrett Jordan for his leadership on this prayer line. There is a healing circle of prayer on Mondays at 7 p.m. We are praying for healing for the nation and that God provides a breakthrough in your lives. We thank Reverend Julianne Robertson for initiating this ministry of prayer and healing. Amen. All the information is in your e-newsletter. If you do not get the church's e-newsletter, then that simply means that you're not on the email list. You can get on the list by emailing your address, your email address, to PlymouthCongregational@yahoo.com, to PlymouthCongregational@yahoo.com, or directly to me, Reverend Hagler, at gshagler@verizon.net. gshagler@verizon.net. Important information is distributed through that newsletter, so I advise you to be on it. We thank all of the faithful members and friends that continue to generously give. It really demonstrates how people want to keep a liberating and progressive interpretation of God's word alive and thriving. We thank all the people who always send in their tithes and contributions through one of the methods that have been made available. And many give even as I make this appeal. So thank you for your faithfulness and for your generosity. Now as you prepare to give, we ask that you be as generous with a Christmas offering for the church staff. Amen. They work extremely hard to keep things going, and in lean times like the times present because of the COVID-19 pandemic, it is important that we show our appreciation. Included in this year's offering will be our talented ministerial staff that provides us with a beautiful and soul-stirring song and celebration. Amen. Our minister of music, Ernest Hargrove, as well as our office manager and building manager. Amen. Show them your Christmas appreciation for all that they do all year long. Be as generous as possible. Also, this being the second Sunday of the month is the Sunday that we take in what is called a benevolence offering. Yeah. This offering helps people who are going through temporary, difficult times, and it is one way in which the church can offer relief. Please be very generous. If you give, you can make a notation either through Cash App or Givelify or even on the website that you're giving to benevolence, that you're giving to staff offering. Make it so that we know what you are giving to. You can give through the church's website, www.plymouth-ucc.org. You can make your tithe, contribution, or donation there. And all the other methods of giving are listed on that webpage. You can give by Cash App. Our cash tag is $PlymouthDC, $PlymouthDC. You can give through Givelify and find us as Plymouth Congregational Church, Washington, D.C. If you pay your bills through your bank's online bill pay, consider making Plymouth one of those payments. The bank will even pay the postage for you. Or you can mail your tithes and contributions to Plymouth UCC, 5301 North Capitol Street, Northeast, Washington, D.C., 20011. We thank you for your love of the church, for your embrace of the good news of Jesus Christ, and for blessing the liberating manifestation of God's word. Let us join in prayer. Lord, we thank you today.
Yeah.
All the gifts that you have given, all the offerings that you have given to us, the blood running warm through our veins, Lord, the perspective that we have in our hearts, the joy that we continue to feel. Lord, we thank you for every gift, large and small. We know that it's not by accident that you have provided. We know, Lord, that it has been deliberate intention because you love us that much. And as we render down back a portion of that which you have blessed us with, we give it to the glory of God. We give it in a spirit of thankfulness, and we give it in a spirit of joy in all of these things we pray today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Chapter 1, starting with the 46th verse through 55. And Mary said, My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, henceforth all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arms. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of low degree. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent empty away. He has helped to spread Israel in remembrance of his mercy. And he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his posterity forever. God bless the reading and the hearers of the word.
Amen.
Here and prepare to go forth in our worship today. I want to just pause for a moment because a couple of additional announcements. One is we're able to do all this stuff online because of Brother Guy Durant and also Brother William Taylor that worked to help upgrade the system so that we could be able to deal with all this bandwidth that we do in terms of broadcasting. So I want to thank them particularly. And I want to thank also the diaconate
for
their faithfulness and stewardship. They're going to be delivering poinsettias today to those who are homebound, bringing light and joy into the midst of their homes. And I want to thank the diaconate for doing that. Also, just to recognize, we have a few people who are here to receive the right hand of God. And so we rejoice in Sister Anita Galloway, who's not here right now, but we receive her. And we receive Isaiah. Isaiah, come on over here a second.
All right.
Oh, yeah. Just stand along here. And we also, Imari. Imari, is Imari here? No? How about Breland? Breland's here, no? You're standing in for them today? But we're gonna bring you back, the family back when times change, and we will formally do that right hand of fellowship and welcome you and all the family, the Galloway family, into the church. Amen?
Yes, sir.
Let us join in prayer. Lord, we just thank you for the Galloway family. We thank you for the ways in which they have blessed this world and bless us in this church called Fellowship. Be with Isaiah, be with his mother, be with Breland, Lord, and we also ask that you be with Amari, Lord, that you lift them up, strengthen them, allow them to feel your presence and spirit and love and joy. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to invite back Reverend Kenneth King.
It's a wonderful day, right?
Yeah.
How many believe that Jesus is the light of the world?
Yeah.
There you go. Come on, how many of you believe that? Hark, the herald angels sing, Jesus, the light of the world. Glory to his newborn King, Jesus, the light of the world. We're walking the light, the beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Shine all around us by day and by night. But Jesus is the light of the world.
Hark, the herald angels sing, Jesus, the light of the world. Glory to the newborn King, Jesus, the light of the world. We're walking the light, beautiful light. Shine bright, shine all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the light of the world, we are walking the light, beautiful light. Come when the dewdrops of mercy shine bright, shine all around us by day and by night. Jesus is the light of the
rejoice in God our Savior. And as we come to this time today, I want to lift up the scripture to remind us of the scripture that has been raised and lifted up from Isaiah and from Luke.
Yeah.
And I want to take a few moments and reflect upon those scriptures as we come into this time of Advent. Join us in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this day, this moment, this time. We thank you for this word that is presented, that you will help to cause us to reflect and to see and to understand something that may be presented to us that may be transformative and life-changing. Lord, we just ask that you allow your word to work on us and in us and through us, Lord, so that we can become better human beings. We give you the praise, we give you the honor. And so, Lord, as we come here right now, we ask that you just continue to mold and shape us because you're the potter. Continue to guide us, Lord, because you are the teacher. And allow us to be illumined in your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
I want to speak about this on a subject, the desire to rejoice.
Oh,
the desire to rejoice. Now, I have juxtapositioned these two scriptures. Though they speak to a different time and era, but with the same sentiment. The difference expressed are expressions that come out of each historical moment. Isaiah is an 8th century prophet and speaks in an era of looming political peril, where there are superpowers threatening the sense of security for Judah and Israel. Though this book is attributed to one person, it is not written by one person. The book of Isaiah is probably attributable to the historical Isaiah only in chapters 1 through 39. But other writers take over in history and through political eras and covers the periods of the people's conquest by the powers of Assyria and general dysfunction in the land among leaders, kings, and priests. The chapters of Isaiah are interspersed with prose and poetic commentary written during the times of King Josiah 100 years later, and that the remainder of the book dates from immediately before and immediately after the end of the exile in Babylon, almost two centuries after the time of the historical prophet Isaiah. Therefore, it is impossible for the writings of the historical Isaiah to be contained in the entire book. And in scholastic circles, you will hear people refer to 1st Isaiah, 2nd Isaiah, yeah, and even a 3rd Isaiah, and sometimes a 4th Isaiah. But all the writings in Isaiah comes out of a genre of hope and hopefulness, worry, and being vexed by the circumstances of life, and the ultimate question of what is God doing in the affairs of the people and in the workings of the world. And in Isaiah, we discover that there is contained a deep desire to feel relief, release, joy, and to be able to rejoice again. The poetic expression found in Luke is attributed to the voice, the song, the lament, and the hope of Mary. And it comes out of an era where, again, oppression surrounds the people and the land. Last time it was Assyria, and this time it's Rome. One era, though different players and different circumstances, feel a whole lot like the same assembly of affairs. The moments, whether experienced under Assyria or Babylon or that of Rome, can make a people and a nation feel bleak and sorrowful. And in the sadness, sorrow, and bleakness, people look back to a time when it was not so and project into a future where again the joy, rejoicing, and rest from anxieties can once again be experienced.
Oh, yeah.
We look towards the future. Advent is about the future, about what is before us, about the hope yet to come and the expressions of joy and rejoicing. Yeah. We await change, refreshment, renewal, and for things to be set right. We have lived in the horrors of things being so far afield and out of our control and reach. And now, with anticipation and belief, we trust that we will come to a place of rest, encounter a sacred moment of refreshment, and renewal, feel the light of possibility on our skins, and gather in our being the overwhelming impulse to celebrate that the season of hopelessness is over, and experience the exuberance that comes from knowing that the storm is passing over.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
When we look at this Advent, we look through the lens of a pandemic and the helplessness felt from that. We look at a political season that brought its own anxieties and brings current confusions. And we now know what the result of political apathy can be, where someone emotionally unfit to occupy office is able to do so.
Oh, yeah.
In the aftermath of the presidential elections, we have seen just how irrational a large segment of the country's population is. Yeah. There are people who do not believe the pandemic is real, that the current occupant of the White House did not lose the election, and that the election was a fraud rather than facing the realities that black, brown, people of color, and whites voted him out.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Why do you think the votes that the so-called president and the Republicans want thrown out are in places like Philadelphia, Atlanta, Detroit, and other cities where there is a concentration of black people and people of color? We continue to live with the language of political avoidance, where what is defined as the political split between right and left, or conservative or liberal, is actually racial and racist, and illustrates the pernicious nature of white supremacy. Now, when the announcement of Pennsylvania going for the president-elect was made, spontaneous dancing took place in the streets. I think it was Robert Doswell who was telling us on the night in which Obama won, there was spontaneous dancing and celebration that took place in the streets. People took to the streets in celebration, danced and sang as if a great weight had been lifted and that the darkness of a long and perilous sojourn was finally at a close and the light was beginning to shine like the dawn. They danced in the streets as if a dictator had died, as if the Berlin Wall had come down, as if the long night of enslavement gave way to the bright dawn of the Emancipation Proclamation. You see, we have within us a desire to rejoice, a desire to feel hope again, a desire to allow our spirit to blossom into a joyful hopefulness. We have within us a desire not to dwell in gloom and in sorrow, but a desire with which to meet the promise of God.
Yes.
Now, I'm raising this up because this is what these two scriptures are about. You know, I know very often we get into church and we want to be Pollyannish. We don't want politics in our scripture. But if you look at the scripture in Isaiah or Luke, you cannot take the politics out of it.
Oh, yeah.
Mary talks about pulling kings down from their throne and confusing the proud in the imagination of their hearts.
Yes.
Isaiah says the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because God has anointed me to preach good news to the poor and recover of sight for the blind. You know, I know we get caught up in this thing where we want to distill somehow our spirituality from our political reality, but it cannot happen. It's artificial. It's not real. The fact is we need to wake up and understand that God is calling for justice and newness and hope.
Oh, yeah.
God is calling for some refreshment out of the old.
Yes, sir.
Some healing out of the brokenness. Some function out of the dysfunction. You see, this is what this scripture is about. It is about the proclamation of a new day, a new way, new hope, a new spirit of joy, and a reason and a purpose to rejoice. The book of Isaiah thunders in the 61st chapter as if to wake us up from our slumber and sleep. The words of Isaiah startles as if to say, do you not get it? Yesterday is over.
Yeah.
Do you not understand that all the problems that we have memorized and fall back on are no longer relevant? You ever notice how you talk to people sometimes about what's going on and all they can do is go back and talk about everything that was wrong in the past? And they get stuck there and you got to shake them out of being stuck in the past and get them to the present where things have changed and where God has breathed a new breath onto the situation.
Sit.
You see, we get so comfortable. Yesterday is over. Do you not understand that all the problems that we have memorized and fall back on are no longer relevant? Let the past go. And look to the future because it is a new era, a new moment, and a time where God has broken into the sorrow, into the harshness and bleakness. And those who encounter the good news of God, like Isaiah, rejoice in saying, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Because the Lord has anointed me, has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captive and release to the prisoner, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint heart. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins.
Yeah.
They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastation of many generations.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You see, it is not an accident that Jesus, upon the beginning of his ministry, opens the scroll to the book of Isaiah and reads from the 61st chapter. Each are saying, all the old stuff, the broken stuff, the beaten up and beaten down stuff is the stuff of yesterday, and we are into a new day today. The Spirit of the Lord, the Spirit of God is ready to rest upon us to bring the good news. Not the bad news, but the good news.
Yes.
It is the good news for the oppressed, the brokenhearted, the captive, and the prisoner. Now, if you will notice, where the good news is promised is in all the places and among all the people that good news have been denied historically. This good news is a comforting one, where instead of ashes for mourning, a garland of restoration and elevation is offered.
Yes.
Now, if you know what a garland is, it's usually some type of green vine with leaves on it, and that is woven together to make a necklace and hung around the neck as a symbol of honor, or placed on the head as a crown. It is a far cry from the ashes of mourning. The gift of God lends to us a mantle of praise instead of a faint heart, a boldness to break forth and break out and to even build up the ancient ruins. Raise up the former devastation, repair the ruined cities, the devastation of many generations. Now this is saying something. Because can you imagine how overwhelming it looks and feels to see a city and cities that have been sacked by military action and have been in ruins, not for one generation, but for a multitude of generations?
Oh, yeah, all right.
Just think about it as you drove through Washington, D.C. after 1968 and how U Street looked from 1968 until not too long ago. The fact is, it was that it felt overwhelming. to repair the ruined city. The task was overwhelming at best. But what the text is offering is the ability to stretch beyond the expected and seemingly almost natural and reach towards the less obvious, towards the breakthrough and towards the breakout, and to feel and confirm that the midnight is past us if we only let it go. The midnight is gone if we only let it go. The bleakness is gone if we only let it go. The brokenness is gone if we only let it go. The fact that we are down on ourselves is gone if we only let it go. God is trying to reach into us and pull out of us the negativism and hopelessness and touch those atrophied places where joy, rejoicing, and hallelujah shouts have been shattered.
Yeah.
Now the writer of Luke focuses upon the song of Mary, and Mary rejoices. Mary rejoices from the old and into the new. Mary rejoices not because she does not understand what is going on and how it affected her and her people. Mary knew all too well the misery of oppression, let down, sorrow, and heartbreak. Mary knew all too well what it meant to be refused and turned away, and what it felt like to exist as a pregnant teenager in a world of maleness and testosterone, and yet God touches her in her condition. And she says in response to God touching her in her condition, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant." Now, why would she say this? And how could she say this? Somehow she has reached into the reservoir of joy and rejoicing.
That's it.
No matter her circumstance and no matter what others are saying, she has decided to rejoice. No matter how the world is trying to tear her down and disparage her, she has decided to rejoice. She's decided to put her stock in God and not her stock in human beings. She is rejoicing because she looks not at what is wrong, but what God is promising as right. She experiences joy and rejoicing because God has chosen her, called her, gave to her a spirit of overcoming and coming through. And she is able to give thanks and rejoice in God and rejoice even in her circumstance. Listen to her words as I begin to close out. "Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their heart. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in the remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." Yeah. Mary's sense of fortunes have shifted. The proud have had theirs. The rich have had theirs. And now the hungry will be fed. The captive released.
Yes.
He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their heart, brought down the powerful, lifted up the lowly, filled the hungry. And a poor teenage girl is the vehicle for this radical readjustment in the world. Think about the radical nature of the story. That the one who is the most hopeless, the one who is the most helpless, the one who is the most feeble, is the one that God chooses to endow with the power to bring a Savior into the world. Mary, you see, is rejoicing.
Yeah.
She has tapped into that place where the world is transformed, even as the stark realities around her still surround her. Mary rejoices because God sees her, no matter how poor and lowly she is. She rejoices because in her powerlessness, God bestows tremendous power upon her, and seemingly a nobody and a nothing to bring something and the Savior into the world. There is something to rejoice in.
Oh, yeah.
There is something to rejoice about. There is something to feel joy in and to share that joy with others and with the world. You see, we each have that deep desire to rejoice, to feel the joy, and to express the joy. Why are you holding back? Why are you fixated upon the broken and damaged things of life and living? Fixated upon what is wrong, than the new vision and seeing that God is pulling you towards. If you can see where you have been and where you are now, and where God may take you, if you've seen the brokenness and damage, and from that damage and brokenness you can refocus your possibility at newness and know that things do not have to be the way they were, but can be what God intends.
Oh, yeah.
And your hopes hope, for then you know that there is something to rejoice about and to rejoice in. What I mean is that you know how far you've been down, and you know how far you've been up.
Right.
You know what you have lacked, and you know what you've had. And you know that God has restored it all. God has given it all. If you've ever been through midnight, if you've ever been through the darkness,
all right,
if you've ever experienced the heaviness and sorrows of life, and if you've ever been made to feel that you don't count and were unworthy, and yet in the midst of all those feelings, something else took hold of you.
Yep.
Something else took hold of you and began to shake you. Something else took hold of you and began to cause you to tremble. Something else took hold of you and caused your spirit to rise up. And you experienced the warmth of God breaking like the dawn in your life and lifting you to new purpose, new understanding, new energy, new mission, and making you feel the joy rising in you like the sap in a tree in springtime. There is something to rejoice in.
Yes.
We have at our core the deepest desire to rejoice, and it is our rejoicing that brings us through the difficulties of life. Mary says, "My soul magnifies the Lord."
Oh, yes. Yeah, yeah.
"And my soul rejoices in God my Savior." We all have that deep desire to rejoice and to experience joy. And we do that when we hear God more than the broken messages of this world. Rejoice.
Yeah, rejoice.
Rejoice. You can get a racist tyrant out of office. Rejoice.
Rejoice.
Rejoice. We can come through a pandemic. Rejoice. Rejoice, because we are still worshiping and loving God and giving God praises no matter what is going on around us. Rejoice. Rejoice, because people can organize to feed other people when people are without food. Rejoice.
Rejoice,
rejoice, because we still got up this morning. Rejoice, because there is still today and tomorrow. And God has a mission, and God has a purpose, and God has a reason for us to be here. Rejoice. We each have that deep desire to rejoice. So I dare say to you, start rejoicing right now. Philippians chapter 4, verse 7, 4 through 7, reminds the people to rejoice in the Lord always. And then I love it, because he comes back, he says, "Again, I say,
rejoice."
Rejoice. If you didn't get it the first time. If you didn't get it
that's
the first
right,
time.
That's right.
If you don't understand it the first time, if you don't understand that we're to overcome all the odds, that we're to overcome all the difficulties, that we're to overcome all the sorrow, that we are to be a breakthrough people, trusting in God more than we trust in the muted equations of human beings. Rejoice.
Sit.
And if you don't get it, again, I say, rejoice. and give the glory to God, for we have this deep desire to rejoice and to share in the joy of God. Let us join together in prayer. I pray somebody here today, you know what's been missing. You feel what's been missing. The power of rejoicing has been missing in your life. And we're just going to ask, oh Lord, that your Holy Spirit, your sacred touch, touch a heart, touch a mind, touch a being, touch a soul. Remind us, Lord, that we are to be a people that are rejoicing and moving and marching and doing. That we are people ignited with hope and light. Lord, touch somebody here today, because somebody needs to feel some light today and some joy today. Remind us, Lord, that we have this deep desire to rejoice, and we are people of God. Allow us to rejoice. Lift somebody, bless somebody, save somebody today from sorrow, Lord. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name, and the people of God said amen.
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 And amen.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive the King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders and wonders of his love.
Invited to this communion table. As you gather at home, we invite you to gather together whatever sacraments you're going to use to join together virtually in this unified communion service. And we just ask that you continue to reflect upon the promise and goodness of God. Because it's at this table we recognize the brokenness of the world.
Yeah.
Because it's at this table that Jesus is betrayed. It's at this table that Jesus' heart is broken. But on the other side of this table, there's spirit to rejoice. There's spirit to feel the joy. For God renews brokenness. God heals brokenness. God takes that which is we think is damaged, and God brings about the repair. Yeah. So we're reminded of that this day at this table as we gather to partake in these elements, this cup and this bread. I'm going to ask that somebody will lift up a prayer for the bread and somebody will lift up a prayer for the cup.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come to this sacred table.
Yeah.
As we bow in humble submission and adoration, we ask you to bless this bread, which represents your body. And may we always remember that you are the bread of life.
Yeah.
You feed our souls, you nourish our hearts, and you give us the strength to face this race before us. This is our prayer in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray for the cup. Love came down on Christmas. The star and the angels gave the sign. on this third Sunday of Advent, as we take and drink from this cup, we know the truth that you, O great Creator, loved the world so much that our Christ came and died for us. By your Spirit emblazoned on this cup, the message of your love and our ability to rejoice that love was born at Christmas and then grew up to offer itself fully and freely on Calvary's cross. And so we pray for a blessing for the cup. Amen.
Amen.
As we gather here at this table, we're reminded on the evening in which our Lord and Savior was betrayed, he took bread. And after he had given thanks for it, he took and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Each time that you take of it, do it in remembrance of me." And likewise, I remind us to remember all of the bodies that have been broken in the struggle for justice and for freedom and for liberation. As their bodies were broken in the struggle, we remember them. We remember Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. It was on that same evening that he took the cup. And again, after he had given thanks, he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins and for the creation of a new society. Each time that you take of it, do it in remembrance of me." And likewise, I remind you to remember all of those whose bodies, whose blood has been shed in the struggle for justice and freedom and liberation. As their blood was shed in the struggle, we remember them. We remember Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Come and eat. Come and drink. It has been prepared for you. Our deacons will serve you. And we ask that you hold the communion until we've all been served and we may take the communion together. Let us take and let us eat this and do it in remembrance of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us take and let us drink this and do it in remembrance of our Lord and Savior, Jesus our Christ. Let us join together in the prayer that we were taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever.
We're going to rejoice, and again I say what?
Rejoice.
Again I say what?
Rejoice.
Until we meet. Until we meet again. God be with you. Until we meet again. Till we meet. Till we meet again. God be with you until we meet. Oh, until we meet again.
Thank you.
are still listing, and those who are here, there are poinsettias that are for sale, and the cost is about $20, is that correct?
Yes.
$20. Please pick one up, and so you can help defray the cost as those poinsettias go into people's homes. Thank you so much. God bless you. That's wrong.
Wrong.
I didn't recognize him with the haircut.
And he has hair.
Oh, so I'm gonna get a poinsettia.
Okay. You can give your money to Deacon Taylor.
Okay.
Or you can give it to me. Whatever.
Deacon Kelly.
You accepting checks? You got checks? Can you accept
checks? Yeah, of course.
Oh.
Make it out to
them. Well, I don't know that old cash is tempting money.
All right. That's what we're working on. Put down in the middle line.
We ain't got no money.
You discover every day, right?
Granny, I mean, Granny. Gary, did you did it well today? You did it well.
Hydration.
That's right.
So chemo, one day, and